Kings, he is indeed. Good evening, Grace Bible Church, and welcome to worship this Sunday evening. It's a pleasure to be here with you, and let's start our service off with a call to worship. This Sunday is Pentecost, so we are actually reading from Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound, the multitude came together, and they were bewildered because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished, saying, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us in his own native language, Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians, we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God." And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" Now, brothers and sisters, let's sing once again.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord, with divided tongues like fire and the sound of wind that roared. He hath loosed the Holy Spirit. Let us rise. Yeah. to make men holy. Let us live to make men free while God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Jesus, shine. Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory, blaze, Spirit, blaze, set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow, flood the nations with grace and mercy, send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Lord, I come to your awesome presence, from the shadows into your radiance. By the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. As we gaze on your kingly brightness, so our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Mirrored here, may our lives tell your story. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. nations, with grace and mercy send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze, set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow, flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions, wash away all my iniquity, and I will be whiter than snow. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me.
Lord Jesus, I long to be perfectly whole. I want you forever to live in my soul. Break down every idol, cast out every foe. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Whiter than snow. Yes, whiter than snow. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Lord Jesus, look down from your throne in the skies and help me to make a complete sacrifice. I give up myself and whatever I know. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Whiter than snow, yes, whiter than snow. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. This is what I pray. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. You are the change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you.
Good evening once again. Now, typically on a Sunday evening, we take an opportunity to lift praises and prayer requests as an assembly, and we lift them before the Lord together in prayer. This evening is going to be our last recorded service, and we will be meeting live next Sunday night, June 7th, and that is a praise to report tonight. So for one last time on recording, I'll be lifting our praises and prayer requests before the Lord on your behalf this evening. Would you please join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to come before you once again, Lord, to be in this place and to worship you, Lord. Lord, we thank you so much for the opportunity that we could be tuning in all these weeks, Lord. Lord, that the gospel never stopped going forth in the midst of this quarantine, Lord, the midst of this pandemic. Thank you that your word is unstoppable. We praise you for that, Lord. Lord, we thank you so much for the wonderful service that we had this morning. What a glorious day to come together. It feels so good to fellowship with one another in person again, even if it's socially distanced and in the back parking lot, Lord, or in our parking lot. Lord, we just thank you so much that we have the ability to see our brothers and sisters in Christ in the flesh. Zoom calls are great. Facebook is wonderful. Online services are nice and cozy and comfortable from the couch. But there's just something so special, Lord. We praise you. We praise you for the togetherness that we are able to share. And Lord, we praise you that next week we can begin getting together in person once again, Lord. Lord, we pray that the weather would be great, that we would be able to do so, Lord. We thank you so much for the faithful people of God here at Grace Bible Church that have endured and that have been patient and that are ready to get back together to hear your word go forth, Lord, and to fellowship with one another. Lord, there's so many things to be thankful for, Lord, and yet there's so many things to lay before you in prayer. Lord, we lift our country before you. We lay it at your feet. Lord, many decisions to be made, many voices talking, lots of noise and lots of clutter. Some of it's gone away with the pandemic. Some of it's even stronger. Lord, I pray for your discernment. I pray, Lord, that you on this Pentecost Sunday, Lord, this weekend of Pentecost, would pour out your Holy Spirit on our land, Lord. Heal our land, not just from this current affliction, not just from the coronavirus, Lord, but heal our land from the many, many years of sin, the many, many years of turning our back on you. Lord, I pray that you would show mercy on the United States of America. I pray that you would stir up the Christian men and women and children, Lord, the entire body of Christ in this nation, Lord, that you would stir us up to be your hands and feet here in the United States, to point our brothers and sisters back to you, Lord, not just through words, but through action and deed, through showing our brothers and sisters, working together with our brothers and sisters, and showing our fellow countrymen your love, Lord, and preaching the gospel, Lord, not the watered-down gospel, your truth-filled gospel, just as it is, just as it's right in here in the Bible, Lord. Your word is so important now more than ever before. Lord, I pray for everyone experiencing affliction right now. Lord, I pray that you would draw them close to you. I pray that you would whisper in their ear. Give them a hug. Stir up their heart, Lord. Lord, just let them know that you are there. People that don't know you and that are far off, Lord, you love them too. And we thank you for that. Lord, let them know you're there. We pray that a mighty work would happen in the heart and soul of our nation as a whole, Lord. Lord, again, we pray that your Holy Spirit would be stirred up in the church, that you would give us strength to accomplish more than we could ask or imagine, Lord, more than we could think for your kingdom. Thank you for the privilege to do kingdom work for you, Lord. Lord, I pray that you would encourage us and inspire us to do more kingdom work for you, even when we think we're busy or we're tired or we don't know where to begin. Lord, please show us the way step by step by step, Lord. Take our hand and lead us and guide us wherever you would have us go, to do whatever you would have us to do, to lead a fellow person towards you, Lord, to point them in your direction. We know that you do the work, you alone. We can't do the work on their behalf. We can't do the work on your behalf, Lord. But Lord, we know that we can take part in your kingdom work by pointing our neighbors, pointing our families, pointing our friends, and pointing strangers alike in your direction, Lord. And when they encounter you, what an amazing experience it is. We pray their lives would be transformed, Lord, and we pray that they would surrender to you. Lord, we thank you again for all of your many blessings, and we thank you for the wonderful message this morning from James. Lord, I pray that you would be with Pastor Justin this evening as he comes forward to deliver the message. I pray that you would fill him with the Holy Spirit as he delivers the sermon on Numbers chapter 30. Lord, give him encouragement. Encourage our pastors, both of them, Lord, Pastor Justin and Pastor Bob. Lord, I pray that you would encourage our elders. I pray you would encourage our deacons. I pray you would encourage our ministry heads. I pray you would encourage everyone here, Lord, that does service in your name. Just encourage us this evening. Challenge us. Challenge us, Lord, and teach us. Teach our hearts. We look forward to diving into your word. And it's in your Son Jesus' most beautiful, wonderful, and powerful name that we ask all these things. And the people of God said, amen.
Good evening once again. Let me invite you at this time to open with me to the book of Numbers. And we're going to take a look at chapter 30 tonight. It's a relatively short chapter, only 16 verses. But the topic is vows, the taking of a vow, and really the stipulations around how a vow could be canceled, particularly if a woman, and what the conditions were if a woman were to make a vow. So what we're going to do, since the chapter is so short, is we'll take a look at some other verses as well about what the Bible has to say about the taking of vows and keeping of vows and whether or not they're really necessary and should we still be making vows. So take a look again here, Numbers chapter 30, and I'll just break it down the way the text breaks down for each relationship or each person and the situation that they're in. For men, it's only going to be these first two verses, and then the rest of the chapter is going to be if a woman makes a vow and all of the different scenarios in which she might make that vow and whether or not she has to fulfill it. So first, just verses 1 and 2 here on if a man takes a vow. It says, Moses spoke to the heads of the tribes of the people of Israel, saying, this is what the Lord has commanded. If a man vows a vow to the Lord or swears an oath to bind himself by a pledge, he shall not break his word. He shall do according to all that proceeds out of his mouth. So just here in this opening two verses, we set the principle down. This is going to be the principle for the rest of this chapter. This is going to be the principle throughout the Word of God. If you say something, then you ought to mean what you say. You ought to do what you say. And so in this case, he's speaking of men because, as I said, we're going to have some situations in which women can be forgiven of the vow without actually having to fulfill it. But in every case for a man, if they say something, they ought to do it. And so here he uses two different words. One is what's translated vow, which basically means something that you agree to do. And then the other is pledge, which most commentators think means something that you agree not to do, something that you'll abstain from, that you're swearing to abstain from. For example, the Nazarite vow would be more in the category of pledge. And we had that earlier in Numbers chapter 6 was the Nazarite vow. That seems to be a very specific situation and the specific things that are promised there and the various rules around that are different here. This is just vows in general and really the bulk of what the Mosaic Law has to say about the taking of vows. Now, vows could be made for all sorts of reasons. Basically, you are promising to do something for God in return for Him doing something for you. So, you know, usually people will do this when they're desperate. And, you know, they'll promise God, right? If you get me out of this situation, I will do X. I promise to do X. And we need to be very careful, and in the scriptures, they needed to be very careful about making vows that they weren't putting the Lord to the test, that they weren't testing His goodness or His faithfulness. In essence, God, you know, you have to get me out of this. So if you do, I will do this. But Lord, you have to do your part first. In essence, forcing the Lord's hand by making the promise, by making this swear. This was to be avoided completely. Deuteronomy 6:16 makes it very clear never to put the Lord to the test or to tempt Him. And so these vows would be of a different nature. But certainly when, you know, you have your back up against the wall, you might ask the Lord to act on your behalf and make a promise that if He does, you will do something in response. Now, there are several examples of that kind of vow in Scripture. For example, Jacob promises to worship God and to give God a tenth of everything he owns if God would protect him. It's Genesis chapter 28. So that's kind of an example of this vow. Lord, if you protect me, if you keep protecting me, if you bring me through this trial, then I will give you, you know, this tithe and worship you. Jephthah makes a vow, and it's a very famous one because it's a rash vow. It's a foolish vow. He promises God that he will sacrifice the first person that comes through his door to greet him if the Lord will give him victory in the battle against the Ammonites. Ends up being his daughter. You can see why it was a rash vow, a foolish vow. Even so, he does honor the vow. He keeps the vow. Hannah, 1 Samuel chapter 1. You might remember Hannah going and praying to the Lord for a son because she was barren. And the Lord gives her a son, and she prays and promises that if the Lord gives her a son, then she will return the son to the Lord and to his service at Shiloh. And the Lord gives her a son. She brings Samuel to Shiloh to honor, to fulfill the vow and to serve the Lord. In the book of Jonah, the sailors, who are pagan sailors, but still another example, they make all sorts of promises to God if he'll save them from the violent storm at sea. So you have all these various examples about vows. And we'll talk a little bit about what Jesus has to say about it, what the New Testament says about it. But here you have this principle, verses 1 and 2. If you make a promise, you keep your word. There's no outs for it. There's no stipulations. There's no, oh, but. You say something, you promise something, you do it. Now, as I said, for the women, the rest of the chapter, there's going to be different scenarios in which a woman finds herself, whether they're still young enough to be in their father's home, whether they're married, whether they make the vow before they're married, whether they make the vow after they're married, whether they're widowed. So let's take a look, and as I said, we'll just take these one at a time. First, verses 3, 4, and 5. This is women who are still young, at home, and make a vow. It says, if a woman vows a vow to the Lord and binds herself by a pledge while within her father's house in her youth, And her father hears of her vow and of her pledge by which she has bound herself and says nothing to her, then all her vows shall stand, and every pledge by which she has bound herself shall stand. But if her father opposes her on the day that he hears of it, no vow of hers, no pledge by which she has bound herself shall stand, and the Lord will forgive her because her father opposed her. So if a woman makes a vow, young woman still at home, makes a vow or a pledge, then she must keep her word. Once her father hears of it, he doesn't do anything. He in essence, approves it. He doesn't even have to say he approves of it, just that he doesn't disapprove of it. Then she has to fulfill the vow. If when her father hears of it, he says, no, then she's forgiven. The Lord will forgive her of the vow. She does not have to keep it. Now, with each of these cases, what we'll see is that the man, whether it's the father in this case or the husband in the cases to come here, that they have a say in whether or not the females in their lives have to keep their vows. So we see here another principle that's held up throughout Scripture of the responsibility, right, the headship of the household that God gave to the men, whether it's to the father or to the husband. And so the women cannot make these vows apart from the approval of the male head in that household, whether it's the father or the husband. So as it is with the father, here we'll see similar stipulations with the husband of the fact that the wife does not have to keep the vow if her husband opposes it. And so we see the idea being, and we see this other places in Scripture as well, that the man is responsible for the household, for the health of the household, for the household's honor to the Lord. And so if she makes a rash vow, since he's responsible and he ultimately has the final say, he can cancel the vow. Say, no, wait, that was a rash vow, that was a foolish vow, you're not going to be keeping that vow, and he can cancel. So that was verses 3, 4, and 5 with, if it's a young woman still at home, not married yet, in her father's house, if her father opposes it, she does not have to keep that word. The Lord will forgive. Verses 6, 7, and 8 is, if a vow is made by a woman still in her father's house before her marriage, but then later she marries. So if she marries a husband while under her vows or any thoughtless utterance of her lips by which she has bound herself, kind of get a sense of how the Lord feels about these things, then her vows shall stand, and her pledges by which she has bound herself shall stand. But if on the day that her husband comes to hear of it, he opposes her, then he makes void her vow that was on her and the thoughtless utterance of her lips by which she bound herself, and the Lord will forgive her. So if a woman already under a vow or pledge that she has made, maybe her father has approved of it, she hasn't fulfilled whatever the promise that she made is yet, and she gets married. Now, when her husband hears of her previous pledge that she made while in her father's house, he has an opportunity to say, no, oppose the vow, and she's forgiven. She's freed from having to fulfill it. She's not forced. Then the next phrase, in parentheses here, it's for widows, but any vow, or those who divorce, but any vow of a widow, verse 9, or of a divorced woman, anything by which she has bound herself shall stand against her. So there's no longer the male head in that house, right? She's either divorced or she is widowed. Then she makes this promise. There's no man there to oppose it. There's no man there responsible. And so she has to fulfill her word, just as the man does, verse 1 and 2, right? Because the point still is, if you say something, you have to keep it. You have to keep your word. You have to keep your promise, all right? Now, yes, the father, the husband could oppose it, but otherwise, you must keep it. Now, if after she's married, verse 10 here, verse 10 down to the end of this, after she's married, she makes a vow. If she vowed in her husband's house or bound herself by a pledge with an oath, and her husband heard of it and said nothing to her and did not oppose her, then all her vows shall stand, and every pledge by which she bound herself shall stand. But if her husband makes them null and void on the day that he hears them, then whatever proceeds out of her lips concerning her vows or concerning her pledge of herself shall not stand. Her husband has made them void, and the Lord will forgive her. Any vow and any binding oath to afflict herself, her husband may establish or her husband may make void. But if her husband says nothing to her from day to day, then he establishes all her vows or all her pledges that are upon her. He has established them because he said nothing to her on the day that he heard of them. But if he makes them null and void after he has heard of them, then he shall bear her iniquity. These are the statutes that the Lord commanded Moses about a man and his wife and about a father and his daughter while she is in her youth within her father's house. So if a woman makes a vow or pledge after marriage, similar to the previous situations, she does not have to keep her word if her husband, when he hears of it, opposes her. If the husband does not say anything, then she must keep her word. He's upholding the vow. If the husband does not say anything, and so she has to keep it, he establishes it, he's aware of it, he hasn't opposed it, hasn't challenged it, and then later changes his mind and opposes the vow so that she's not going to fulfill it, he's responsible. Goes again back to that responsibility for the household. So he had the opportunity, right? If she makes maybe a rash promise to the Lord and he heard of it, he had the opportunity to say, no, we're not going to do that. You're not going to do that. But if he didn't say anything, if he heard it, said, okay, and then later thought, no, he is now responsible for the breaking of that vow. So obviously, one of the main ideas here is that a woman or a child still in her father's house cannot make their own vows and then, you know, nullify their duty to fulfill it. Nobody, it stands, of themselves, can make a promise, make a vow, make an oath, make a pledge, and then after the fact say, you know what, I'm not actually going to do that. You know what, that was rash, that was foolish. You know what, I really promised more than I can keep. Nope. Everyone, what you say, you must do. All right, so now there were those, the husband and the father could cancel it out, but nobody could cancel out their own vow, their own pledge. What you say, you must do. And it shows again this idea of the submission to the leadership of the males in the household. So a child can't say, you know, sorry, Dad, the milk I got from the cow this morning, I dedicated it to the Lord. I promised God when I woke up this morning, my dad's going to make me milk the cow. But Lord, I'm going to give all of the milk to you and to the priests. I'm dedicating that milk to you. If his father hears of it, he can say, no, son, no, that's our milk. You're not giving that to the Lord. If he says, yes, today the milk belongs to the Lord, then the son could fulfill his vow. So you get the idea here. But he has to, in his father's house, or her in her father's house, has to honor father and mother. Now, Jesus mentions this, Matthew chapter 15. So here's where we'll kind of move away from this chapter and take a look at some things elsewhere in Scripture that really help to fill in some of maybe what you're thinking about. Well, what do I do with this today? Do I have to keep my word? Is it okay for me to make a vow? Well, so Matthew chapter 15, Jesus says, let's see, verse 4. The God commanded, honor your father and your mother, and whoever reviles father or mother must surely die. But you say, if anyone tells his father or mother, what you would have gained from me is given to God, he need not honor his father. So for the sake of your tradition, you have made void the word of God. And Jesus is speaking to the scribes and Pharisees here because this tradition developed that, no, if the son makes this promise to disobey his parents but honor the Lord, then that's what he ought to do. He ought to keep that promise. But Jesus says that they're breaking a commandment, honor your father and mother, by telling the child to keep his vow and disobedience to his parents. So in this case, Jesus calls this form of vow making one where one would claim they are worshiping the Lord, they're honoring the Lord, but by doing so, they are breaking a commandment, sinful. Jesus is saying that's a sinful application of the vows, and that developed from tradition. We just saw what Scripture says, right? In other words, one could not make a legitimate vow requiring them to do a sinful act to keep it also. So I think that is implied here, that if you swear to do something to the Lord, make this promise to the Lord, it's going to break your honoring your father and mother, but worship the Lord. God says, no, I told you what to do. You honor your father and mother. So you must do that. Everett Fox is a commentator and translator of a number of scriptures, including the five books of Moses. He writes, the length of the chapter, and 16 verses, which we might say, well, that's a short chapter, but the whole thing was about vows. It wasn't just a couple passing verses about vows. There was all these different situations. So Everett Fox says, the length of the chapter signals the importance, or rather the sacredness, of an oath in ancient Israel. It stood as uttered unless an annulment procedure was followed. Now listen to this. Human words, and not only divine ones, were seen as having effects in the real world. If you say something, that you make that utterance, especially in this case, you're making this vow, this promise to God, that you have to do it. It's not just empty words. It's not just in the moment saying something. Right, we're supposed to, just as the Lord always does what he says, so every word that we utter, we are to do. If we make a promise, we are to keep it. If we make a vow, we are to fulfill it. Now, one other example, I didn't mention this one earlier, but in Genesis chapter 3, we have a kind of an illustration of Eve. Now, she doesn't make a vow per se, but she makes a rash decision. And Adam is there, right? It says she gave to her husband, she gave to Adam, and he ate. And so when we think about that situation in view of what we just saw in Numbers with the relationship with the husband and wife, Adam's silence, right, that he had the opportunity there to step in, but his silence in the narrative and not opposing Eve and what she's done makes him culpable for his wife's action. So we see, right, that he's responsible there. Right, when the Lord comes, and Adam is cursed along with Eve, and because he's in essence agreeing with her, as though by not saying anything. So, it's extremely important that we keep our word. That we keep our word. Now, Jesus told his disciples, "Let your yes be yes, and your no be no." Don't make promises or swears. It's not really necessary, right? Think about, today. It is a very, very applicable chapter when you think about how easily words fly off our lips, right? And I think of how in Ecclesiastes, in Proverbs, in James, the need for us to be very careful about what we say. That it's better for us to be quick to listen, but slow to speak. That it's good for us to let our words be few. And it's wise for us to not talk a lot. Proverbs says that very clearly. It's wise for us to really think about what we're going to say and filter what we're going to say before we just blurt it out. James talks in chapter 3 about how dangerous the tongue is, right? How deadly the tongue is. That we can, a lot of that chapter, he's talking about how we can attack people, right? We worship the Lord and then we strike people with our tongues. But also in this context, how rash we can just make a promise. I mean, think about it. You might swear in a conversation. You might think that it's necessary to swear, swear in the sense of make a promise, make a vow. All right, I swear by whatever that it's true. And I think that has developed in our world because nobody believes anybody. Because we've all broken our word so many times that as a society, as a culture, as a world, nobody's word means anything anymore. Right? So we have all sorts of contracts and agreements, everything that has to be signed to prove, okay, you're going to do X. You can't just say you're going to do it because we recognize everybody breaks their word. Everybody, says things and doesn't really mean it, doesn't really fulfill it. And so we've developed this swearing, this vowing, is adding on top of our word, right? Such and such is true. I don't really believe you. I swear that it's true. I swear that I didn't do it. I swear that I'm going to do this. I promise that I'm going to do this. Rather than just saying I'm going to do it. Jesus says that ought to be enough. It ought to be enough for us just to do what we say we are going to do. In reality, vows and promises are unnecessary. We don't have to make a promise or a swear or anything like that. Just do what you're supposed to do. Just say what you are going to do and do it. Adding a vow to something, a promise to something, should not, in people's ears, elevate it, say, oh, now they're going to keep their word, or make us feel responsible to keep our word because we made a promise. No, just keep our word. Just say what you're going to do and mean it. And this is why it's wise for us to be very careful about what we say. Because the words just fly out. What we say is serious business, serious, serious business. Now, I don't think Jesus says that all vows are wrong. For example, think marriage vows. Two people, man and wife, making promises to each other. Think church covenants. Right? Somebody joins a church. They're making a vow to the church that I'm going to be part of this body. This is going to be my family. That I'm going to serve here. I'm going to keep you accountable. I want you to keep me accountable. I'm going to put myself under the leadership of the church. Right? I'm making that vow, making that covenant with the church. I'm going to follow the rules of the Constitution and bylaws and what it says. I'm going to seek to obey Scripture. I believe it's the Word of God. I understand what happens when I sin and what the consequences are of that sin, right? So we're making promises. We're making an agreement there, similar to a contract that you might sign. We see God do this several times, right? God makes covenants with people. So it's not the sense that all of this is wrong, that all vows or all contracts or all covenants are wrong, but we must be very careful because we say things, words just fly out of our mouth so easily. And Jesus' point is, as it is with the vows in Numbers 30, our word is binding. That's why we have to be so careful because what we say, we must do. I take, for example, marriage vows. People enter into them and think, well, I just want to be married. So, okay, I got to go through the ceremony. All right, I'll stand up in front of the people, blah, 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 I'll say these things. It's very tradition, right? Until death do us part. Right? We just use traditional words. We say, make these promises. And then the divorce rate is 50%. Church covenant, same way. People join a church, say, make that promise to the church. And they don't like something, so they leave, they move on. Have a disagreement, rather than work through it like they ought to, just move on to another church. Or a contract. Maybe we make an agreement via contract. We're going to repay something, or we're going to do something, and then we maybe break it, or we find a way out. Our word is binding. That's Jesus' point. What you say, do. And so that ought to be true of us as believers. In a world in which people don't keep their word, Christians ought to keep their word. If that means saying less things, then say less things. That means you have to be very careful about what you say you're going to do, then be very careful. Mean what you say. Right? Numbers 30, Jesus, throughout the scriptures, made it very clear that we're not to lie. And it's lying if we make a vow, we make a promise, we make an agreement, we say anything really. And then if we think that we aren't bound by it, it's sin. It's sin. And so we need to make sure that we keep our word. May we be people who keep our word, who mean what we say. All right, let's pray together. And God, I do think of what James says in chapter 3 there about how dangerous the tongue is, Lord, how deadly the tongue can be, how easily we just let words fly out of our mouths. And God, how easily it is for us to make vows even in our day. We see how significant it was in ancient Israel. But Lord, it's so applicable to us today, God, because we make all sorts of agreements. God, we can even make promises to you, Lord, if you will deliver us from whatever the trial that we're going through, Lord. We promise we're going to do X. Are we really? Or do we just want you to keep your end without us keeping ours? God, help us to be people who people can trust. And God, when we do break our word, and there are going to be times when we do, God, let us not lie about it, hide it, try to explain or excuse our way around it, but rather just be honest and confess it and recognize, yeah, I was wrong. I was wrong. That's the heart that you want, Lord. You want a heart that is like yours, honest, that does what we say. And Lord, a heart that is always broken over our sin. So God, may we be people that others can trust. God, help us to be careful about the things that we say. Help us to keep our words fewer than they often are. May we say things more that we need to say or ought to say, rather than just letting things fly. We thank you, Lord, for your grace to us when we sin. We thank you that we have relationship with you that we can never lose because of Jesus. And we ask, God, that your Spirit would convict us in this area, instruct us in this area, help us in this area, Lord, to be honest people, to be careful people. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come and rise to your rest.
It's so good to feel your presence in this place. My brothers and sisters, let's go forward this evening with a benediction from 2 Thessalonians. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Brothers and sisters, we look forward to seeing you next week in person. Meanwhile, have a wonderful week. God bless.